So, hello everyone, and so now today we are going to talk about integrations. I think it's a very exciting topic. So I think every IP Next user, like all of them, they want to actually use features like third party features with the data they have on IP Next, and with all IP Next has to offer, I think it's a pretty likely case. So talking about integrations, we already have a Shopify connector, and the QuickBooks connector has been contributed by the community itself. There's also talk of a Magento and a WooCommerce connector. So if you go and search on like the forums, connectors are quite an active topic. So, but kind of it turns out that syncing data is not a very easy job to do. So if you take an example, like if you have suppose 500 products on Shopify,
we want to sync like 500 products. I think that's a very small amount, but okay, let's go with it and try to sync. So the first problem is like the fields of an item on ERP Next will be different from those that you have on Shopify. So you'll have to first figure it out how to map them. And in case any time you, once you're done with the connector, you've built it, and later on in the future, if Shopify decides to somehow change their field name, you'll have a pretty good time finding and replacing all the fields that were first hard coded, and now you have to change them. So, next up, okay, we imagine that suppose the connector does that. So currently we have like zero items and we are syncing. We sync 10, 20, like we reach 80. So far so good. And now suddenly, maybe your cat decides to jump on the power button and the sync fails. So, right. Now you have to actually figure out that where the sync stopped. And not only that, the items that had already been synced, you need to catch up from there. You need to know what had been synced and what is remaining. So even if you manage to sync like 80 items or maybe even all of them, so the items that have already been synced are also not the end of the story. That those, if you go on and change something in those items, so the next time you sync, only the updated ones have to be resynced, right? So in addition to the new items, even the updated items. Also, if like when you're syncing, you need to know what was the last sync time. So that way you'll come to know that what are the items that have to be synced next. Another very real pain that developers face are API changes. So we recently had this discussion on like Dropbox uploads that we were facing, that the uploads kind of break in the middle. So there was one option to actually chunk the uploads that we sent. Like we sent the uploads in chunks of files. And we were glad that we found it. But it turned out that the chunking was in the version 1 API. And sadly, we noticed this. So whenever a software changes the API, we have a really hard time actually refiguring out the entire connector and building everything from scratch just so we update the way like how things are being done right now currently. So yeah, the use case for this is also like data import. So can we have a show of hands, like how many of you all have faced problems in the data import tool in IP Next? Right, so what was the problem that you faced?
Large amount of data. I needed to import large numbers, 47,000 item groups.
Yeah, so what do you expect when you import data? What do you expect it to do? Like, How do you expect that we press the button and all the items like come on?
You expect it to be easy.
Yeah.
And for the items to just upload once you have the format correct.
Yeah, sure. So that's the thing, that we cannot actually just press the button and expect all 10,000 or 50,000 items to be in your system right there instantaneously. So that's supposed to work somehow similar to Dropbox. Like when you sync from Dropbox, it actually syncs in the background. and lets you know how many items have been updated, like what the sync is going on, are they up to date. So that's what we can actually do in Frappe as well. So if we push the job of syncing to the background in batches, that actually is less error prone than it will be that we try to sync all data the data in one go. So I think you are starting to see a pattern here, that though the use cases differ, the problem actually still stays the same. That is a problem of data migration. So now, so once we boiled it down to this, that this is going to be coming up, cropping up in everything we implement. And as Achilles already showed us, that the Frappe framework has everything from connections to API and everything. And as well, Zarar had already started working on the schema mappings from a Postgres database. We decided that we will counter this problem once and for all and work out a solution that actually solves it, so that the implementer doesn't have to. So what we came up with was the data migration tool. So the data migration tool will act as a middleware whenever you're syncing data. That is, you don't have to worry about all the problems that we just now faced. So this is what it looks on the outer surface. You just have to give it the connector that will actually connect to your remote system, which will have the credentials. You give it the object mappings that will depend on the objects you're trying to sync and whatever schema they have. And then the data migration run, which is a part of the tool, will figure out how to do the syncing. It will batch it, it will delay it, it will defer it, it will enqueue it, and you basically don't have to worry about the syncing part. So this is what happens, that the data, when fed into the tool, given the connector and the mappings, it will automatically run the run and your data will be synced to Shopify. So that's all that's taken care of. We are batch syncing. You can set the batches in the mappings. You only sync the updated data so it knows when was the last sync, and it checks the modified timestamp of the items, and based on that, it will only sync the data which have a greater timestamp. It has field mappings, so you can explicitly set the field mappings, or you can also pre-process and post-process the docs before you map the fields. And also, we handle failures. Like if there were any problems during the sync, you catch all the errors, you note them in an error log, and retry on the next sync. So now, enough talk. I think we'll demonstrate how we use this to actually solve our own workflow. So credits to GitHub for managing that, but we figured that we can use its data in a better way. So next, Faris will be demoing that how we created the GitHub migration.
Hello. So let's get dirty and write a data migration for GitHub. So before that, let's talk about why do we need a GitHub integration. So the current workflow, what we have is we have issues. We have developers assigned on those issues. But as ERPNext is a multi-repo project, we have Frappe, ERPNext, and other repos also. So that is a pain. The thing is we have milestones, but we can't have multiple issues from different milestones in a single milestone. So we have to maintain multiple milestones for multiple repos. So we can solve this the good old way. We don't have reports on GitHub. We have reports on ERPNext. So let's make a GitHub integration. So what we'll do is we'll sync the milestones on GitHub to projects in ERPNext and issues in on GitHub to tasks in ERPNext. So this is the basic diagram. Let's see how we'll do it. So we, for the data migration tool, we have a few doc types. The first one is data migration plan. So the data migration plan, as you can already see, we have a HubSync plan. So the data migration plan is a basic plan for your sync. So it holds the steps. So we have company to hub company. So these are mappings from remote object to ERP Next object. So in this case, we used a data migration tool for hub. So we have to sync the ERP Next company to hub company. Let's make our own for GitHub. So let's say this is GitHub sync. And we'll put it in integrations. So right now, we'll have to give it a mapping. So let's make a new mapping. So first we are syncing milestones. So let's say milestone to project. And they are called milestones on GitHub. So we say it is a milestone. Let's give it. So you have to give the primary key, which uniquely identifies each milestone. So let's check what, so I have already looked it up. So I think GitHub milestones API. Let's see what fields they have. Okay, so this is the sample response. As you can see, we have ID as the unique primary key. So we say ID, and we'll have to sync it with project. And project has project name as the primary key. We know that. And we'll have to set the mapping type to pull, because we are pulling from a remote source. Okay, so let's give it the field mappings. So the remote, the first field name is we are syncing is ID. So ID will be synced with I don't think we need ID. Okay, let's sync the project name. So we have title as the field name for milestone. So we say title, and we have project name. What else? Description. Let's see what is the description field for project. Notes, I think it is called notes. Refrm dot dot dot. Yes, it is notes. All right. What else? State. Do we have state in project? Yes. This. I think we call it status. Yes. So we'll also sync the status, but it is called state on GitHub. So let's call it state, and we are have. What else do we? Okay, let's keep it at that. Okay, so now we have a first mapping. So to connect to GitHub or any remote source you are trying to sync, we need credentials to authenticate. So for that, we have a connector, data migration connector. Let's make a new connector for GitHub. I'll call it GitHub connector. I'm so good with names. Okay. Don't get excited. This Postgres does not work. So we either we can select from standard connector types. So we already have a connector for Frappe. So two ERP Next instances can sync with each other, or we can have our custom connector. So let's. So for this, we'll have to give the dotted Python module. So does it? Let me to save. Okay. So let's make a Python module for. So I think it is in the Frappe repo. Okay, so we already have these JSON generated. So all the settings we just now set. So it generates JSON, so you can commit it to your code. So let's make a new module for GitHub. So let's make it under integrations, say connectors, and new file. What do you think will be the name? Obviously. Okay, so we'll have to give the dotted path. So we need init.py. So we have init.py here. We need to make one here. Okay. So we already have a Frappe connector. So let's copy paste that code and override what we want. Frappe connection. Okay. Let's copy this. So as you can see, we have a base connection. But this was a relative path in Frappe connection. So we'll have to give the absolute path. Let's find out where base connection is. Or let me first override this. So for GitHub, I think Python has a library called PyGitHub. Yes. So it works with V3. We also have V4 now. Okay, so we do the import like this. And also let's rename it to GitHub connection. And how do we connect? Okay. Okay, so first we give it. So this is the basic. So I think it will. Oh, I didn't specify. Okay, we'll do it later. Also, the name field. This is the primary key for objects in GitHub. So let's give it ID. We just saw that milestones have ID as the name field. Also, you can see we have four methods which we have to override. So the good thing about data migration tool is these four methods are all you have to write to connect to GitHub. All the syncing and syncing in background is all taken care of by data migration tool. So we'll only be doing pull. So for pull, we only need to override the get method. So we'll write the get method. Let's just delete these from the Frappe connection. Okay. So let's give the dotted path here. What it is? Frappe integrations connectors. What else? GitHub connector. Obviously. Okay, it does not recognize the path. Frappe. Forgot. Thank you. Doc type. I think it is connector. And connector again.
No, it wasn't connectors. Yes, it's in connectors.
Connector.
Yeah.
Doc type connector connectors yes. Dot base. Okay. Okay, let's hope this works. All right. So let me also set this. Okay, so we have set up the data connector. What else? So let's go back to plan. So we have set up the basic setup we have to do. We also have to do tasks. Let's do project first. So for running this connector, we didn't write this get method. Okay, so let's see what is the API. No documentation. So let's do it for a Frappe repo. So I think we'll have to get the repo. Does it have a get repo? Get repos. Get repo. Okay. Let's try get repo. So we have this self.connection. We can use it to hopefully get repo. I think this will work. So we'll have to pass this from filters. Okay, so we have these standard arguments which are passed during the run. So what we want is the repo can be any repo, so we'll have to pass it from the settings. So let's say for project we want the Frappe repo. So this takes a valid JSON. So you can put any valid JSON and you can you'll get the passed JSON inside your get method. So save it. So we'll have it in filters. So filters dot get repo will give the repo. Okay, so hopefully this will carry the data from repo, and we have to sync the milestones. Okay, so also this is a generic get method, so it does not know if it has to sync milestones or issues or pull requests. So this doc type here will will get this remote object name. So I think this should be remote object name. So we'll check it with if remote object name is milestone, because we also have to do it with issues. So let's do it for milestones, and we'll make a helper method for getting the milestones. It will take a repo and paging, because we only want to do it them in batches. So let's give it default arguments. So it will fetch this. If we so also we have to return it, I think. So get milestone should return 10 milestones for one batch. Pass it the repo and start, because we are we also get the start and page length. So this page length is passed here. So if you set it to 10, the batch size will be 10 and 10 milestones will be synced at a time. So all good. Let's return repo dot, does it have get milestones? If it is a good API, it will have. Yeah. Okay, let's try it. Should we try it in the console? Okay, let's try it. Oh, we didn't install this. So we also have to put it in requirements. So let's add it there. Once you add a new requirement, you just do ben setup requirements. So when setup requirements also does npm dependencies. So let's see if we have let's import GitHub from GitHub. Yes. Okay. I think I can do it without. Like this. Yes, it works. Okay. So API is good.
For those who does not know about bench console command, so it basically bench also provides some utility. Bench console just opens the Python interpreter, and it also connected to the MySQL, and all the Frappe API is available into the console. So you can execute any command, you can test, and
you also get pretty colors.
Yeah.
So I think. Yes, yes, it is IPython. So we don't want to get all the milestones at once. We just want 10 first. So we'll have to use slicing. So I think we can give 0 to 10. It will give a slice of 10 milestones. So okay, so we have to, now to give it here start, and start plus page length. So it will give only 10. So am I missing something else? This is self dot get milestones, and okay, let's run this. So for running this, we have another doc type. We have doc type for everything. So for running this, we obviously have data migration run. So let's give it GitHub sync and the connector and save this. No, it will set it from the mapping. Okay. So let's run this and we get an error. Let's see what failed. Okay, all right. So we did not, we missed, yes. So we have this class, we did not make an instance of it. Let's give it a get connection. Okay. So let's see what data migration connector takes. So this is the wrapper which handles all the connection. So it expects a get connection and we pass the connector here. So we are getting connector here and we'll give it connection. So we are also getting the connector here. Okay. So that works for the standard connectors, Frappe and Postgres. This is for, okay, we'll. Okay. Okay, I'm still learning. I think this should work. Let's run this. Error. Does it not? Now we come to field mapping. So we can also pre-process the fields because this, so we are returning the data, it is getting the data, but we have to mold it to how we want it. So for the mapping, this mapping, we can pre-process before it is sent to the data migration tool. So we can add pre-process methods here. And it will get the milestone object, which we get from the connector directly. And we'll have to return a dict with the fields we have set here. Where is that? Plan. So what it expects is three fields, title, description, and state. So let's give it those fields. Milestone dot title. This has to be done because dict and object, and these are different things in Python. State milestone dot state. Let's check if we have these fields.
So in the mapping, you can use get ATTR also as an option.
In mapping?
So you can either look for a dict or you can look for attributes in the object. That might be a better place to fix it actually.
So, okay. I did this in, I think, the run.
Run, yeah.
Okay.
Can you try to fix it or?
Or should we go with this?
Okay.
Let's check what this gives us. So this is the milestone object. We have title. We have.
No, so wherever you're expecting dict, you should try both methods. You should try get. If it's a dict, or get ATTR if it's not a dict.
Okay.
So the other, the greater point is that since you also control the framework, you know, these are opportunities to improve the core methods rather than try and do a duct tape.
Okay.
So in your run, just open your run document, right? Where you've created the run.
So I think I did this here,
yes.
And not there.
Yeah, so abstract this get value method.
Okay.
Get value, and then you know get source value.
So we can do it in get mapped record. Get mapped record. So this is done in mapping. So we are using dot get here.
So get is only for dicts. So we have to also use get ATTR for objects.
So does it work for both objects and?
No.
So we'll have to try catch.
Or is instance. Get source value. Self and both you'll have to get self field map and key or source and key, right? Source because it's function name, your source.
So get it here.
Is instance. So if okay. Is instance
okay,
right? If then source dict. Then use get. Return source dot get key. Else get it here. Since we don't have a third way of returning objects so far. No, else just return source get it here. Get it here, yeah, source and comma key.
This could probably be added to the utils.
No, I think this is, we can get into it, but for here, this should be.
Where else are we using that? Here. Field map. So now we don't need pre-process. So we can remove this. Awesome. So let's hope this works.
Yeah, use another criteria.
So source value has to be outside, not inside the class.
But we are facing problem here. I think we can replace this with get source value. Okay, so some progress. So the status is set as smaller case open on GitHub. So we'll have, I think now we'll have to pre-process. Do we have a title function in method?
Dot title.
Obviously. So can we make a copy?
We should be able to pre-process one field also. So it's a pre-process field name, source value, and then you don't have to do that.
And it should always return a dict behind the scenes, right? No?
Value, check if there is a pre-process function, and then you know if that, then you the get source value should also do the pre-processing. But okay, now let's just dict, and I think for.
We have to return a list here. Connector, GitHub connector. So this should be a list. Oh, let's check. Projects. Oh, we have. So that is the GitHub connector. You can also do issues the same way, and we'll also improve it so it does more work. So you don't have to.